All right, let's get this show on the road. Hi there, and welcome to Accidental Origin, the weekly web writing show. And I'm gonna go to face transition. Boom. Hi there, y'all. So my name is Brendan. This is Accidental Origin. Tell you a little bit about what's going on. So this week, I have started a game design competition called Game Chef, and I thought, well, originally I wasn't going to do it. I was going to keep it on with a short story. I thought it would actually be more fun and keep things interesting for us if I just did the game design stuff on stream. I've gotten a bit of feedback lately from some of my friends and viewers about that I'm super serial all the time. I'm super serious. And I might come across as trying a little bit too hard, which is fine. I mean, that's what feedback is for, right? So I didn't really plan much for this week. Like, I didn't sit down and knock out a lesson plan sort of thing. I'm kind of winging it, and it feels like I'm winging it, at least at the moment. We're gonna talk game design. When I was at the convention a few weeks ago, for those of you who are here for that, I spent 3 hours and did like a game design, role-playing game design workshop with a local designer by the name of Jason Pitt. Who's a cool guy. He's won some awards and stuff in the role-playing game community. I learned a lot. And we're going to talk about some of that stuff. So cool. Alright. So, let's start. We're going to go to... here. This one. Cool. It's a stream. So this is the game design competition that I'm working on. It's a analog role-playing game, or an analog game design, not a video game. And it's kind of interesting because it has a theme, gives you 4 ingredients, and it's like a 9-day thing. So it's like very short. It's going to be this episode, and I believe the last day will be, it's the Monday after the next episode. So I'm probably going to spend 2 episodes on it. So cool. So the theme for this year, I don't know why it says 2015 there, because it's actually 2016. But the theme for this year is technology, which is cool. A lot of the times when we talk about technology, we're talking about computers. We're talking about current modern day technology. But that's not what technology has to mean. I mean, technology has kind of shaped society for a long time. The wheel is technology. Fire is technology. And that's really what this theme is about. It's about changing the way that we think about things. Advents in engineering, advents in thinking. So cool. Technology. And then the four ingredients, which we got here. I'm actually going to pump this up a bit. Let's go. Zoom. There we go. That's more readable. So yeah, the ingredients for this year are alarm, dance, sketch, and sunlight. Which all have interesting connotations. And part of the challenge of this competition is that it is a... you're supposed to interpret. So, yeah. And I mean, Chess Dagger, technology can totally be a theme. Thematics are some of the, like, most intricate and the hardest to define things about writing. So technology can totally be a theme. And I mean, in terms of game design, it's not even that I necessarily call it a theme, but they're calling it a theme, so it's the theme. But yeah, thematics, themes can be pretty much anything. Yeah, I had a full thought there. I don't know where I went, but that's fine. So yeah, I'm just scrolling down the rules here, trying to give you guys a general overview of what's going on. So there is a big thing about accessibility. Your design should be accessible for everybody, especially blind, deaf, or colorblind people. Submission stuff, 4,000 word limit, various submission and intellectual property stuff. Cool. We all get the idea? Yeah. Awesome. So, we're now approximately 2 days into the competition. And yes, Johnny, it is a Super Mario themed shirt. I'm 2 days in, so I have actually spent a good deal of yesterday thinking about my concept for the game. So like I did with the short story writing, I'm kind of going to show you my thoughts on this whole thing. Yeah, so there is a word limit. It's a analog game, so it's actually about writing a set of rules. Most of the designs that come through this competition are role-playing game designs, specifically narrative role-playing game designs. So storytelling games, kind of like in the style of Fiasco or Dungeon World or that kind of stuff, Apocalypse World. It's not a hard limit. There's a 4,000 word limit, but you can submit more. It's just one of those things where the judges aren't guaranteed to go over. The judges aren't guaranteed to go over anything above 4,000 words. So. Yeah. What am I thinking? Oh, right. Sorry. Yeah. Looking through my notes. Look at this page. Oh. Man, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that it's buffering and all that stuff. Yeah, there's not much I can do about it right this second. My internet is doing significantly better. I'm getting the least amount of frame drops I've ever had. So, yeah. yeah, okay. Right. This is why I plan things. So, I've been thinking a lot about Zork lately. Me and my friend Sam have been discussing it a lot. It kind of came up a few times this week. So I've been thinking about Zork. And we were talking about MUDs in general and things like maps and map making and how difficult it is to figure out those kind of worlds. So for me right now, I'm kind of interested in map making, which is awesome because for the theme of this game design competition, technology, I'm going to use cartography as my technology. Right? So, we're going to write that down. And cartography. Oh, okay. Cartography. So, we're going to talk about map making. And stuff similar to that. All right, what we got? Cool. Right. So map making. And the reason I went with map making, A, because of technology, B, because of Zork, and C, because it actually deals with one of the ingredients. It deals with sketch. So cartography, for me, sketching, a map. That's my key ingredient here. And in that vein, we have to give the players a reason for sketching the map. And I think that reason, I'm skipping steps. Sorry about my thought process. So when you talk about sketching a map for me, I'm reminded of games like Zork, like the old Fighting Fantasy style games, which are awesome because those I absolutely love Steve Jackson's like Fighting Fantasy game books, which were basically like a role-playing game in a book, choose your own adventure style. They were hella fun. And if you've never checked them out, you should. and exactly. Zork draws heavily on D&D stereotypes, and Dungeons & Dragons deal crazy with map making. In fact, a lot of the move sets in Dungeons and Dragons, a lot of Dungeons and Dragons stuff actually like deals with specifically like your bow can shoot this many squares, this many meters, and you can measure that in squares and stuff. And exactly. So the game I kind of want to make is that kind of style game where the players literally take turns making the map, building onto the map, and build this whole bigger picture of what's going on. That's kind of the style of game I'm looking for right now for this. So what else we got? As usual, my thought process eludes even me. So cartography. The other kind of stuff that I would like to include, but don't necessarily need to include, is I'd be interested let's do wants, not needs. Let's do that. Goals. So I would like this to have a single player mode. Mostly because if you're like me, a lot of good role-playing games involve a group, and groups are hard to organize, especially around real-life stuff. And I have no time. Like, all I do is work full-time, write, and stream. Like, that's my life. So I'd like a single-player mode for people. Not necessarily something that's necessary, but something I'd like to add if I have time. I think for the goals, we're gonna use alarm, like a sanity sort of meter style, like the old Call of Cthulhu games, or Eclipse Phase, some other games like that. So alarm can be that. It can also be like some sort of ticking clock with the alarm. Hence why alarm, right? So there's that. Sunlight. Dance and sunlight are kind of the hard ones, and I've been playing around with a few things in discussion with some other people, specifically my friend Sam, and we haven't come up with anything perfect yet, but we're gonna talk that out. I mean, we're gonna talk about this kind of stuff. So, for me, in a lot of ways, this is a game about, like, almost a do-it-yourself board game. I'm gonna grab a thing here. Yeah. So what we got? We got our handy dandy graph paper here. I've heard Eternal Darkness was a good game. I never played it, though one of my exes was really, really into it. And I love that concept. I heard it was really buggy. Like, it did not run well. But I'm absolutely in love with the concept. Absolutely. So, we got graph paper. Now, for me, I was thinking that this game would kind of be a game that required dice, a pen, and graph paper. So it'd be almost like, I have an idea. Where's my thing? Apps. I'll find it during the break. We'll do it up. But the concept I was kind of playing with was a map drawing game. So you literally draw your map as part of the turn. So yeah, we're gonna just gonna keep writing stuff down as we go. Split this up. Doing fancy things with my software. So new here. Gameplay. So on your turn, you get to draw a map section. I should blow that up so people can see. Yeah, there you go. But how are you going to draw that map page, map section? What are the rules or restrictions that you have as a player? What input do the other players have, other than getting to draw their own map squares on their turn? So a lot of the ways that I was thinking about this was randomly generated. So on your turn, you get to roll on a table. And none of this stuff is final, by the way. This is just, like, these are my thoughts as we go through the concept. So rolling on a table, but then you're kind of rolling, just rolling and things are happening, and that's not as much fun. So what if you did something more like a fiasco style roller? Which has a dice pool. Interesting. Sunlight. Yeah. I'll think about that, Jess Dagger. I'll think about that. Keep it in the back of my mind. I'll even write it down on my sheet. Light versus dark. Cool. So, I was thinking of a fiasco-style dice pool. For those who don't know, fiasco, I'll pull it up here real quick. Fiasco is a storytelling game designed around the concept of playing a story. There's no combat, there's no... nothing like that. It's a narrative game, so the players get to take part in the narrative design of it. It's pretty cool. So basically the idea of Fiasco is that you take a 3-4 dice for each player, I think it's 4, you roll them all at the beginning, and then every time then you go around the table, and each person takes one die, and that die decides something about the story. Each time someone decides something about the story. So, for example, I played one when I was at the convention, and we were on a steamer ship, like the Titanic sort of style thing. Heading from England to America. And I played an engineer. And an engineer was one of the things that could be selected. So, how do I describe this? It's like there was a big dice pool of like 5, 6s, 1s, 2s, all that stuff, like 6-sided die. And to select something, you had to take one of the die of the type that you selected. So a 2 stood for a relationship between two characters. You select that, and that would be their relationship for the story. Which is fine. I don't need to explain Fiasco super detailed because we're not talking about Fiasco per se. But the idea that I was going with would be that there would be a number of dice for each player. A number of dice, one for each player. And every turn, roll all the dice, and the active player, let's say, gets first pick. I'm missing. Roll the dice. Then the players each take a die and select something about the room. The active player gets first pick and draws the map. So yeah, the concept would be, oh, do I have dice nearby? I might have dice nearby. Anyway, the concept would be, if there were four players, it'd be four dies. The active player would roll the four dice, four dice, and they would get first pick. So that, say you got 2, 3, 4, 5, for example. I pick a four, and on my table of of rooms, the four stands for a stone room. And then the person to my right goes. They pick a three. So then that means that there's a magic chest in the room. The next person goes around, picks something. That means there's four exits. Or whatever, like, set it up like that. So everyone contributes to how the rooms are designed, and we draw them on the graphic. Right? So that's kind of the concept I'm going with. Because it gives... It takes some of the control out of the active player, as well as giving all the players something to do on every turn, so you're not necessarily just waiting for your turn every time. It changes up how... because it's a random table, you don't necessarily need to have a dungeon master or a game master or anything like that. The players can kind of set the narrative and set what's going on. So yeah, those are that's the main concept I'm going with. Make a new doc here. So then, what's the goal of the players? What are they trying to accomplish? How are they accomplishing this? Right? What obstacles do they face? And these are all kind of questions that I want to use to establish what's going on in the game, why we're making certain decisions, how the game is going to be played, and what's kind of how the players are interacting with each other. So, who are the player characters within the world? What stats, if any, do they have? What do our tables look like? Is there going to be combat? If I can spell, there will be. When do we roll dice? And I'm not talking about necessarily the map dice, but just dice in general. What types of rolls are there going to be? Software. So, because the theme is technology, and we live in a modern day age, and I also want this game to be accessible, so I had thought, as part of the process, that it'd be really cool if you almost had a computer program that could read out the randomized prompts, and do that kind of thing, where it could give you more feedback with what's going on. It can keep track of the table, certain things like that. That's definitely a that's definitely a want, not a need. So I'm gonna say software audio cubes here. I think it'd be cool, but at the end of the day, it's not something I think I need for the playability of the game at the moment. But it depends, right? Because it depends on how the mechanics of the game work. For example, I'm thinking that it's possible that having less than a certain number of players would make the game unplayable. Obviously, a good like you design it so it wouldn't be, but your other option is providing a way for there to be more players when there's not more physical players through software or through different control setups. So those are things you can do. Excuse me. A big question. Are the players working together or independently? Are they competing against each other? I guess competing would be better here. How are they interacting with each other? Can you mess someone up? Give them setbacks? Force them to be behind your goal? Can you, if you work together, if you all win, or like if you work together, you either all win or all lose, or do you want a game that has a clear winner from the group? These are decisions we have to make, right? So those are kind of what I've been thinking about, this kind of stuff. So, yeah, we're going to talk about setting, and we're going to talk about stuff like that. When I was discussing stuff with Sam, for me, when you talk about dungeon crawling and that kind of style, you're really talking about a fantasy game. That being said, there are very different types of fantasy, right? You heard my talk last week about genres and stuff. There are different types of fantasy. So if we're going to have a bunch of players who are cartographers, people who make maps, that's what the players are going to be. They're going to be cartographers. So if they're cartographers, why are they in the place that they're in? Why are they in a dungeon? Fantasy dungeon crawler cartographers. Why are they in the dungeon? The way I was thinking about it was that they would be sent there by a nearby village to explore. Why would they be sent there? Or, in the words of Sid Field, what would they be sent there for? And I don't have an answer for that yet, but that's kind of the way that I'm thinking about it. For me, also, I was thinking about it in a way that the sunlight could be their end goal. Like, they're trying to escape the dungeon. So there's certainly that. So the narrative that I'm starting to see here is that explorers are trapped underground on an expedition and are forced to escape to the surface. Something like that. So that's what I have in terms of narrative here, setting. Sam suggested to me that it be post-apocalyptic. He made a good point about how in a post-apocalyptic world, if we jump hundreds of years later, and society sort of rebuilding itself, but they're built on top of the ruins of the previous society. So really, they'd be going down into the dungeon. In order to find and map old technology that doesn't exist anymore, that they can use to better themselves. So, you know, we're starting to see a pattern of, or we're starting to work the theme and the ingredients back in upon themselves of giving us different elements from the same sort of central idea, right? So yeah, this is what I'm starting to see. And go back to my questions here for a sec. So what's the goal of the player? The goal of the player right now, as we've defined it with our setting, is to escape the dungeon. We'll say that. I mean, another word we could use is ruins. Underground ones specifically, but ruins. And how do they accomplish this goal? So what's the goal of the player? To escape the underground ruins. But the other narrative goal of the players is to find old technology. How do they accomplish this? By exploring and mapping. Right? What obstacles do they face? Well, obviously, dead ends are one. Which means that on our table, and I'll make a separate thing here. I'll open up my questions here on the side. I'll split this more evenly. Open up another doc here called tables. So we know that our table entrances, exits. We know that our table needs to have an option for none. Right? So that's, yeah. so they can face dead ends. Traps, maybe. So yeah, I'm gonna open that up here. So then, room contents table. Needs to have option for traps. Oh, well, I mean, here's an even better idea. Rather than having traps as be part of the room contents, why don't we have a separate traps table? And if, say, well, this kind of thinking leads me to believe that all four players would be working against each other. That there's conflict going on, right? Because the way that I was thinking about this is, if you have a traps table, then if someone's in a room with something, you can put a trap there to derail them. Right? So that's the way I'm kind of thinking about it at the moment. We could do both. I mean, you could have a co-op mode or a team mode. There are options. And seeing as this is an analog game, our options are a little bit different than in like a video game or something like that. We don't have to rely on technological limitations in different ways. I mean, it just depends. And hopefully we'll make informed decisions, but there's lots of stuff going on, right? So there's that. So then we have other players. As an option. There's an option of putting enemies or monsters. I'm not sure about that yet, but certainly doable. Depends how much of a dungeon crawler we're trying to make, right? Are we trying to make it a like sort of hack and slash roguelike, or are we trying to like just have an escape thing where they have to fight against the environment? And the enemies or monsters don't necessarily have to be other creatures. They could be certain parts of plants or animals or stuff like that, like flora or fauna. Oh, let's see that thing again. Come on. No, do it. No. Oh, there we go. Right. And if so, is there going to be combat? Is there going to be fight rolls? Or are there other ways? You just have to run from the enemies. I think combat seems likely. But it doesn't have to be the only thing. Because it'd be interesting to have player versus player combat. But again, not something that's 100% strictly necessary. So then, that means when do we roll dice? Well, you roll dice to generate the map. You possibly also roll dice to in combat. Are we going to have certain, are certain characters going to have skills that will help them with certain things? I mean, that's an option. You could give certain characters the ability to be better at traversing certain types of terrain, or there'd be a possible terrain that certain characters can bypass because they have skills or items or something that allow them to do it. It's a possibility. Not saying it has to be there. So yeah, what staff it bring? And the questions just keep going around and around, right? So what staffs, if any, do they have? They could have skills. Movement. Special powers. Combat skills. Or combat stats. Image or damage, HP, MP, that sort of thing. So then that brings up, well, this is answering the second page, I'm gonna pull that out. So that brings up the question of who sets these stats? Is it the player characters? Is it the players themselves? Are there pre-generated characters? Who sets the stats and that kind of thing? I like the idea of pre-generated characters, mostly because if you have the player set the stats, then there has to be some sort of character creation element, and you need to write rules for that. Which is fine, but it's just something to consider, right? I'm going to delete our tables question because we have sort of started on our tables. So now, start asking ourselves some questions, figuring out how our game is going to go. What does a typical turn look like? So obviously, or at least obvious to me, you start with movement, then you generate the room, whatever room they're in, then the player gets action. Actions does the player get? I don't know yet. But I mean, that could be like, thinking of a little bit of Munchkin, for example, search the room. Fight/combat. Use a skill. an interesting idea I just had. What if what if instead of having a global map, every player makes their own? Right? I mean, in this type of game, for things like Search the Room, you'd likely roll on a random table. Randomized table. For combat, is it... is it competing roles? Or just a attack roll. So yeah, it's now 5 to 8, so I'm going to take a 5-minute break, and be back at 8 o'clock, and we're going to continue on this. Actually, I think for the next part, we're going to talk a little bit about game design, stuff a little bit more, and kind of ways of focusing, ways in which we can focus our efforts, because you can't make everything perfect. There's just not enough time. Like it, and your game is going to focus on certain elements. It just is. So, yeah. We're going to go take a break. And we'll come back and talk about that stuff. Cool? Cool. All right, and I'm back. Ooh. And I'm back. I'm on the main screen here. Found I got this up for why we're doing this. Because it allows us to do cool things like mapping on graph paper. Anyway, we're gonna go back here a little bit. Oh, right, that's what I said. We're gonna talk about this. So, change this up a little bit. So let's give our game a working title. Working title. Anyone got any suggestions? Working title? I want to make cartography jokes, but I don't think that's the right thing. Not making spice and dice. That's all in there somehow. How does the game encourage / reward us? Well, you literally can't. You have to make a map to progress. And by progressing, can succeed. First one to find tech and leave wins. All right. So we have that. Talk about some of this stuff. So, you can't focus on everything. So we're going to talk a little bit about what I want to focus on in terms of this game with this design at the moment. So, got some very complicated ideas here. And they are. They're complicated. But there's a few that I can totally show you, like, or totally eliminate right off the bat. So, for example, game is a soapbox. We're only going to do, we're going to have that not be a priority. I'm not trying to say anything about social context with this game. I'm just not. Challenge. Game is an obstacle course. That's literally what this game is. So this is going to be a 3 for us. Right? Discovery. Game is uncharted territory. Again, priority. It's an exploration game. We're trying to see new boundaries. Game is an unfolding story. Probably a 2, because it's not a priority, but it's also not our primary focus. How the narrative develops is going to be up to the players and like certain things, but it's not the main gameplay and mechanics aspects of our game. So how many points do I have out right now? 6, 8, 9. So I have a potential 6 more points and 5 categories. So that means that to me, the other 5 categories are going to be 1s except for 1, which can be a 2. I think that's probably going to be sensation. Game as a sense pleasure. This game is going to have detailed detailed descriptions of rooms. It's going to have a lot of visual elements with map making. And thinking about it now, when I was saying this part about having their own maps, I don't think this will work. Only because I'm trying to make this game accessible. So, for example, someone who is visually impaired is not going to be able to deal with their own map in the same way that other players are. But they might be able to deal with descriptor, audio description of how the game is progressing. So I'm going to go ahead and say that probably not because of accessibility. So yeah, there's that. The other thing is it's gonna get weird trying to track where people are, but maybe that's why we would like to have it be multiple maps. So yeah, there's those elements as well. So there we go. This is what we're doing. It's not, we're not doing any real heavy fantasy. Yeah, it's a fantasy setting, but it's not like detailed social interactions or like really crazy world building. It's very confined, it's very basic. Game is a social framework. It's a competing game. It's a little bit more board game-esque. So there's not a ton of role playing and social things in the same way. And yes, I went with Spice and Dice because I have nothing else in the moment, so it'll do. So yeah. And then game is a mindless pastime. That's not really a priority for me. I think it'll be fun. I think it'll be a pick up and play sort of style thing. I don't think it'll necessarily be a big, like, lot of time devoted sort of thing. So we'll see. And I might just be interpreting that category wrong, but fair enough. And keep in mind, this is a design, an RPG sort of style design, and the game that we're proposing is an RPG. It's more of a board game RPG than a standard role-playing game. Probably more in the vein of like old-school Dungeons & Dragons, or Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, or like the board games based on Dungeons & Dragons. Like Lords of Waterdeep, or some of those, like some of the starter sets had miniatures and stuff. Kind of like that. It's more like that sort of style than it is a like pen and paper, role-playing game, just a rule set sort of game. But so this works. This section, however, on allocated authorities is a little bit different simply because it's there's not going to be a GM, and with the board game elements, it kind of takes away from these things. So for me, I mean, this is a 9 to 12, so we'll see what we have to play around with, but there aren't really going to be NPCs. Actually, that's not true. There might be NPCs. So we'll say either for that. Statements are true in the fiction, only the Game Master. Oh, right. So we're gonna the way we're gonna approach this is we're gonna say that the game master is the rules, and not a specific person called the game master. The game master is the rules themselves. Yeah, Johnny, I was talking about this. Allocate 9 to 12 points. And the reason we allocate points is because you can't concentrate on everything in a design. It's impossible, you don't have time. And a lot of times when you create, especially when it comes to role-playing games and certain things like that, trying to hit everything just gives you a big, giant book that no one uses and is not useful to anybody. You can't do it. You can't hit everything. And if you try, your product is going to suffer for it. So what we're doing with the points is we're kind of allocating who has authority, who contributes, what elements are we going to emphasize, how complex is the game going to be, stuff like that. And these can change, right? These will change over the course of the design. So, for me, the rules state which facts or statements are true. The rules state how scenes begin and end. That's 7. Definitely ones at least. Controlling spotlight and attention of the group. I think it's going to be a 2 because either the rules or the players themselves are going to dictate how those interactions go. So that's 1, 2, 3, 7, 10. I have 2 more possible points if I want to use them. I think this one is going to be 2, and I think that's it. I think that's what we're going to go with. We're going to go with an 11 here. All right, and then complexity, 9 to 12 points. This is going to be a short game. It's not going to be a long game. It's going to be kind of a single session thing, I think. That's what I want it to be at the moment, but there is potential with this kind of design that you could just continue exploring the dungeon for many sessions. But for my focus, I think it's going to be a 1. I think this is going to be a 3. I think with the maps and the way that the maps are going to work and stuff like that, that is going to be a little bit novel. It's going to be complex. Number of participants. The way that we discussed this in the design course was that a 1 would be 5 people, like a general 4 players plus a game master, whereas a 3 would be like a group of 20, like a big LARP or something like that. So for us, I think it's going to be a 1. So that's 5 points. I think relationship is going to be a 1. Because it's pretty just much like just antagonistic. You're fighting everything or you're against everything. Character stats and traits. I'm looking at a 2 right now because I think we're going to have some and some special powers and stuff, but we're not going to have a ton. So I think that's a 2 for me. So that is 8 in total, which means we need at least a 1. Maybe a 2 here. Not sure about that. But we'll see. I'll leave that as a 1 for now. Because we're setting up the setting in the rule set and in the initial setup of the game, we're not really changing the setting a lot. And I'm not planning at the moment of having a really long drawn out setting setup. I think it's gonna be very much oh hey, you're explorers, you're in a dungeon, explore the dungeon, that sort of style. But we'll see, right? Like, there's a lot we can do with this kind of thing. So I'm going to go ahead and save a copy of this. Excuse me. Save it to there. Oop. Save. Yes. Oh, whoops. That was a mistake. Whoops. that was bad. Alright. I'll have to go back and change that afterwards. So this is kind of what we're looking at the moment. And I think it gives a better idea of the areas that we want to focus on in terms of the game design. And the questions and the kind of questions we want to ask. So yeah. Ooh. Talk about this a little bit. Well, actually, let's do some live example sort of a little bit. Oh, we need a dice roller. Let's get a dice roller. All right, so let's talk a little bit about materials. A game obviously requires materials to play. So in our game, or in this game, my game, I guess, what are the types of materials that we're going to use? We're going to use materials. OBS so I can see how far that is. So we're going to need the rules, graph paper, writing utensils, 6-sided dice. We'll say that this is a 1-4 player game. So we'll say 5 to 6 6-sided dice. So these are what you need to play. And the reason I think it's important to talk about materials is because the easier it is for, like, the more likely someone is to have something available to them, the more likely they are to play your game. If they need more things, if they have to go out and purchase stuff, it's less likely that they'll play your game. Right? It's kind of like Warhammer or something like that. It's cool to buy the rulebook for $60 or whatever, however much it is. I think it's actually more expensive than that now. But then you have to spend $200 on an army, number of man hours on, like $100 on paint and modeling supplies. And then you gotta spend time assembling and modeling them and painting them. And then you gotta bring them to the local shop and compete in a 2.5 to 3 hour long game. Like, that's a lot of investment. There's a reason that only hardcore people play Games Workshop games, because that's a lot of investment. This kind of game, I don't want it to have a heavy investment. I want people to have things that are accessible. Right now, the only thing that people probably wouldn't have, the only thing that people don't necessarily have in their house is the graph paper, right? So yeah. There are sounds coming out of my headphones. I don't know why there are sounds. Weird. Strangeness. Yeah, but it's like you won't necessarily have six-sided die like sitting in a drawer somewhere, but you could raid them from Monopoly, or you could raid them from somewhere. 5 to 6 is probably a little bit more, like, you're more likely to find 2 in a board game like that, but you can get them places, like, things you probably have. As well as you can buy, like, a six-pack of dice from the dollar store for, like, $2. $2 Canadian. So that's probably like a euro, maybe. So like spending a euro is a lot different thing than going out and spending like $20 on dice. As well as, like, they're accessible at places. Like, you can go to the dollar store, you probably get them at certain. What am I thinking? Like, you'd probably be able to get them at, like, craft stores or, like, Walmart or, like, general stores. Just stuff like that. They're pretty accessible. Same kind of places that sell, like, playing cards usually have dice and stuff. Things like that. Oh, and the thing I'm hearing is myself. There we go. I had a random window open. So confused. So yeah. What else am I thinking? So yeah, materials. The more accessible they are, the easier it is for someone to play your game. The easier it is for someone to play your game, the more likely it is that they'll play it. Just a general game design rule. So there's certainly that. And the reason that going with something like graph paper with the players designing the game, or drawing the game, is A, it brings a certain level of care of player interaction, player engagement with the game, as well as it doesn't require any sort of fancy map making stuff. Like, you don't have to have expensive printed tiles or pre-made maps or, like, certain other things that would cost you or the players money to make and factors into it, right? So, yeah, I say graph paper. Well, you can go and buy a pad, like, a graph paper notebook for, like, $2. Like, you can, it's accessible. And you don't even necessarily need graph paper. Like, I'm just saying graph paper because it has squares on it. You can theoretically use white paper, lined paper, any sort of just general paper. So we're going to actually change this. We're going to say paper, preferably graph paper. But yeah, just paper. You just need a page, a printer paper. I can guarantee you that people have those in their houses. It's accessible. Trust me. So yeah. right? But I've spent some time, not nearly as much time as I've spent on writing, but I've spent some time learning about design, learning about game design. And the things that I'm talking about with materials don't necessarily apply to video games in the same way. Specifically, I guess in a lot of ways you can kind of equate it to things like polygons and resources. What kind of graphics card do you need to play this at the top quality settings? What technologies can you what technology barriers are there for your players? It's kind of the same thing, right? Like, there's a different type of mindset towards making a game that's only playable by people with $2,000 plus machines than there is for games played on mobile devices, or can be played on your tablet or your cheapo laptop. There's a different mindset that goes into that. So you kind of have to think about, you know, what's required to play your game. And video games can be a little bit different with that, where they can say, well, at best quality settings, you can play it with this kind of hardware. But on medium, you can play it on most kinds of hardware. You can do that more in a video game. Whereas in a board game, you can't really. Or an RPG, you can't really in the same way. But that's also why RPGs tend to be very accessible to people, especially in impoverished communities and stuff. And they've been doing a lot of studies with that, with bringing role-playing games to communities. But where you can give them a $40 book or a $20 book and a pack of dice and some writing stuff, and they can just go and play, right? And it doesn't require that level of investment. So yeah, I don't know. These are important things to take into consideration when you're talking about games. So, in thinking about how we're approaching the game now, when we're looking at this setting, are they trapped in the dungeon? Or are they starting at, I guess this is more of a gameplay aspect, but are they trapped in the dungeon / ruins? Or do they start at the entrance? This has different connotations for how the game will play out, with what's the end goal. So if they start at the entrance and then work their way down, and then they have to work their way back, right? Is different than they start in a random spot and they have to find an exit. And then your tables, you're randomly generating tables. Have to account for entrances and exits. How do you find one? When we're talking about randomly generated rooms, especially the, like, where you're picking off a table, does that mean that the table then has, can you just pick an exit at some point? Or is there other conditions that need to be met before you can find an exit? I mean, perhaps the exits are part of the searching the room action. Right? Where you need, there's a part of that role that requires you to find an exit. Right? So on my room competence table, or let's say searching table, we'll have things like tech, traps, nothing, exit, / entrance, right? Just put a couple of basic traps here. Spike traps, pit traps, poison, gas. No, I don't want to do boulder traps. Anything like the problem with like boulder tracks and stuff, traps and stuff like that, is then you have to kind of you have to account for it moving from room to room, and I don't really want to do that. Maybe moving walls, maybe that's something. It's easier to read. So this table, not being related to the entrance exit that you'd find here, this is about the number of doors out. Contents. This is going to be narrative stuff, I think. Sets the scene of the room. Right? So these are the tables that we start seeing, right? Having it on graph paper means that you can do some interesting things, like saying that like 4x4 room, stuff like that. But it doesn't necessarily mean that. But it can also be things like stone room, wood study, wizards, I don't know, tower, just descriptors of rooms, so things like that. I want to make another. We're gonna set this up to here. I'm gonna make another thing. And we're gonna talk a little bit about accessibility here. It's gonna be my accessibility tab. Did I spell that wrong? As usual. So in terms of accessibility, this game is extremely accessible. To the hearing impaired. Spell game, right? Let me just go back and check the Game Chef stuff a little real quick here. Go down. Right. Oh, okay. This is talking more about writing the rules to be accessible to different people. But I'm thinking about it as well in terms of gameplay. Like, what elements of this game are and aren't accessible to people, to different types of people. I think that this game is pretty acceptable, it's extremely accessible to colorblind.
To the colorblind.
It's right in the same language. You can pick whatever color you want. Like, it's just a pen. You can use a black pen, a white pen, whatever. I think that elements, those elements are inherently accessible. So yeah, there's that. I'm not sure at this point if this game is accessible to the visually impaired. There's some very heavy visual elements. I think, or at least the way that I'm approaching it, having narrative cues in the tables, like, other than your location on the map itself, I don't think that there's, like, other than the map itself, I don't think there's any other elements that can't be done through red dialogue or reading the table out loud to someone who is visually impaired. Like, for example, we're not going to be drawing tables necessarily in the specific room. You can if you want, but it doesn't change how the game is played. So there's that. So then it becomes a question of how can we make the map accessible and, because we haven't quite covered it yet, I'm going to put it in here, go down to the bottom. Whoops. What elements of gameplay make the map making essential? So, the issue I'm seeing here is that in talking about how this game is accessible to the visually impaired, I've come to kind of this realization that in a lot of ways you could cut the map and still play it. And that's cool. That's cool because that means that you can kind of play with it the way that you want, saying this is the way that you would play D&D. You don't have to play with maps, but you can, and stuff like that. That being said, with the theme of technology and kind of my overall general idea of cartography, and that as a technology. How can I make the map essential? Right? Because, like, if it's not essential to how you play the game, then why will people do it? To have a visual representation of where they are versus where the entrance exit is? Fine. That's a decent reason. But, yeah. Like, what elements are there? And this is something I don't have an answer for right at the moment. I don't have an easy fix for making the map essential. But it is something that is worth considering. But this problem is also kind of what I was talking about, where this is, in essence, this is a role-playing game. Where if you cut the map and the map-making gameplay sort of elements, you can still play this game in a fighting fantasy style. Right? Where you can, or in a Dungeons & Dragons style, I guess, where you can say, well, this is what the room looks like. I search the room, I do this, I have combat with this orc. Like, you can do that without having to necessarily have visual elements to it. It's in your imagination, right? Same as a more traditional role-playing style game. So there is that. There is that. So yeah. So what else? What else can I expand on here? I've used two of the ingredients. I've used sketching. And I've used light or sunlight. And it's interesting to me, again, kind of continue on our topic of accessibility and making the map essential, is the only way that I've made the map essential is to the ingredients of the design competition. Right? Like, that's what I've made essential. It's not essential to the gameplay itself. But I think it should be. I think it's important to have all your necessary elements be essential to it. Or why were they there in the first place, right? I don't know. Something I'm considering. But I mean, in a sense, if you're playing cartographers in a role-playing game, you're still approaching the technology and map sketching and all that from a role-playing perspective of playing your role, of your role being a cartographer. So I guess it still is part of the game, even if it's not a physical sketch. Your characters are still technically making sketches of maps within the narrative context. So there is that. Saving grace. Well, excuse me. So, we're going to say something about player characters. And I'm going to switch these. Okay. So, player characters. I do want this to be pretty light on character creation, if there is character creation. I want this to be a pick up and play game. I don't want it to be, oh, we're gonna start playing this game and it's gonna take us 45 minutes to make a character, and then, you know, like, we know everything down to the size of their biceps. Like, that's not super interesting to me as a player. I know some people are into that. There's some crazy games that have you calculate a lot of stuff, most of which are not safe for Twitch, so I'm not gonna mention them, but there's some crazy stuff out there. But yeah. Pre-gen, to me, seems like the best option. Because you can kind of have, like, a bunch of diverse characters. And I would say if you were going to do pre-generated, you would have more characters than the maximum number of players. So probably something like 6 to 8 characters, if you were going to do it. to give your players options, stuff that suits their playstyle, different types of things. So there is that. What kind of stats are they going to have? Well, we already discussed combat stats a bit. So we need some measure of damage or strength. Some way in which we can indicate that they've done damage to an enemy, or their weapon skill, or something like that. Hit points. Hit health. Points. Some way of tracking how much damage has been done. So things like traps and all that stuff can incapacitate you. And that'll be kept track by the players. Oh, that's another interesting note. It's important to know who keeps track of what and how much they're keeping track of. Because the less that someone has to keep track of, the less things that they can mess up, and the easier it is to play a game without having to deal with number crunching and certain other things. Which is why I was saying, like, 4 to 6 sided dice. Because it means that those numbers are fairly easy to work with, and they can only go up to a maximum of, like, 36 as a number. So it becomes much easier to calculate. Having individual players track their own health and stuff like that makes things easier as well. Because that means you don't have one person keeping track of it, you have individual players keeping track of it. So everyone's kind of keeping track of a smaller number of things. So some sort of skill test stats. Maybe like climbing or running, maybe disarming traps. Assuming you find them, you might not. That's an interesting point. So, we have our randomly generated tables, right? And we're sort of using them to set the scene of the players and what's going on. But what if we had... what if the active player only saw the first pick? Saw their own pick, actually. And the rest are hidden elements. See, this seems more interesting to me as gameplay as a gameplay aspect, because it means that if there's traps or if there's certain other things in the room, that the player wouldn't find them. The player who's making the choices, the active player, wouldn't necessarily know about them until it was too late. Which I think is a good thing. It's one of those things where it's not nearly as challenging. It's not nearly as challenging if you have all the information. If you know that there's traps in the room, why would you not attempt to disarm them? But you can't know if there is or isn't if it's secret, if the pool is secret, right? Or you know that there could be potential traps, and you might even know, like, what options there are on the table, but you don't necessarily know all of the information. So that's something to consider, right? Information secrecy. can't spell at all today, apparently. That's what I'm trying to spell. And the same kind of goes for things like finding technology. Oh. See, this is interesting. You could theoretically... you could theoretically have... If you have four players, have five maps. One global map, drawn on by the active player, and each player having an individual one. So then, what happens is each player marks their own map with the thing that they've selected. And that information is only revealed when it's relevant to a dice roll. Right? So then you have information hiding. And say, like, the player beside me has traps on his, and the player beside him has an enemy in his, and then, like, that. And so it's one of those things where, oh, I'm gonna search the room. Oh, you find a trap, and there's an orc that comes out of the next room. Like, things are revealed as you go. Now, a couple of things to keep in mind is, where's the onus on players to not just force combat? Like, you want to give the players options that are just as valuable, that aren't necessarily just killing the other players. So there's certainly that. Excuse me. Yeah. So there's that thought for me, as well as how do you get around everyone picking the same thing? Do you force have phases almost where the first player picks the size? The second player picks the content. Third player, etc. You can do it like that. You could also I had a thought. What was it? So the other thought I had is, if the information is kept secret, you can then have this interesting dynamic. Of the other players conversing about their tactics. Like a little, like a huddle almost. And make their choices. Though, that gives more information to the inactive players, which might not be beneficial. Right? Sorry that. And I agree with you, Chess Diver. There are ways to make combat less attractive, for sure. The problem is if combat is inherently a choice in how you design a room, then how do you, like, what options can be, are more attractive? Especially if we're talking about a game with a single clear winner. Right? And making the options mutually exclusive is exactly what I'm talking about when it comes to, like, phases. So yeah, the other way we could look at it is you could increase the dice pool. I don't necessarily want to do that, but you can do that. Where the first die is the category. Rooms, traps, enemies, etc. And the second is the specific item. So like pit trap, orc, etc. So that's the thing, but then you have to have more dice, and you have to roll more dice, and you got to keep track of it, and like certain things like that. So I don't think I really want to do that, but that is an option, and it might be necessary in order to balance gameplay. Maybe. I mean, in Fiasco you do that, but Fiasco the dice rolls you do like 2 or 3 times per game, and the dice pool just stays on the table for the game. So that's the thing. Right. But anyway, it's 9 o'clock. I'm gonna take another 5-minute break. I'll be around in the chat if you want me to ask me questions. But we're gonna take a 5-minute break and then we come back and we're gonna do the Accidental Book Club and a few of the other things to kind of wind down. I'll review what I've done so far as well. So yeah, 5-minute break. I'll see y'all at 5. And we're back. Okay. So, I had a quick thought when I was on here. Yeah. That is in this one. So we probably need some type of markers for the players. So I'm gonna add that to the list there. Okay. I'm just gonna summarize what we've done so far. And then I'm gonna do the Accidental Club and then close out. Guild of Dungeoneering. I've never heard of that. I will write it down. And I will take a look. I'm curious. Oh, see, I had thought about doing cards, and I love the idea of like making dungeons with cards. The problem is that card games like that are expensive to produce. Not that that specifically matters for a game design competition or anything like that, but it's one of those things where like I'm kind of thinking a little bit further than just the end of the competition. Like, if this idea is any good, then it's possible that I could do something with it. So cards are cool, but they're kind of expensive. And getting a board game published is just hella hard. Like, it's difficult. It requires too much money and resources to do without a publisher, and getting a publisher for a board game is next to impossible if you don't know somebody. it's just really difficult. But it is interesting to consider, for sure. Because I was thinking, like, even something like, if you did, the Search the Room as cards, right? Where what you get out of the room is, like, it changes what it is. Like, you could pick up items or weapons or, like, certain types of things. The technology could be mixed in. So that is something to consider. And having like a deck of stuff that you could possibly print with the product versus something that you'd have to produce is a viable option. That is something to consider. For sure. What have we done? So we've kind of set out our theme, how we're going to interact with our themes. And we'll say setting ingredient here. Sunlight. Getting to sunlight specifically. We're looking at alarm like a sanity meter. It works a lot better in sort of the escape style versus the like going into a dungeon style, but there is something that we could potentially do with this. Still considering it, but there is something that we could do. We have our wants on our needs. I'm likely going to cut at least the first one. The second one we'll see. Mostly because I'm really liking the sort of aspect of having the other players choose things. And the only way that you would get a single player mode is if you had software that could be the other players. So I'm actually going to separate them. Right? Because it just doesn't seem to me like it would work, especially with phases, if we're going to do phases and stuff like that, like it would work with less than a certain threshold of players. These are things that we've discussed. Gameplay. In gameplay, we've talked about randomly generated maps. We've talked about the active player getting first pick and drawing the map, the other player is picking dies from a dice pool in order to generate the map. Entrances and exits, how are we going to handle them? Are you going to have a certain room for them? Hidden elements, like having the players, the players other than the active player, getting to hide their roles. Having multiple maps, and so that they, like, having a global map and then other maps, each player having their own map that they can then have information on that other players don't know about. Even, like, maybe finding technology. Like, if you find technology in a room, having that information on your map versus not everyone else knowing about it, right? Like, ways of obscuring the end goal. Make sure you have a good poker face if you're going to do that. Which, you know, that leads to different interactive, different dynamics of interaction between the players. Different size of dice pools. Yeah. We got a lot of questions. We answered a lot of them, or started answering a lot of them. You know, what's the goal? To go down to the dungeon. Well, actually, I'm going to rewrite this. These were potentials. Potential goals. I think the real goal here for our players is going to be to enter the dungeon / rooms. Find technology. Find the location of technology, because we're map making, but they're not actually taking the technology out, they're just finding things. And getting back out safely. Right? I think that's going to be the real gameplay goal. The other interesting thing about having you go down in and then try and get back out is that... the other interesting thing about having secret information is that if someone doesn't spring a trap in a room or something like that, then if a player goes back through that room, there's the opportunity for that stuff to come up again. Right? So that intrigues me. Global maps. Different types of obstacles. Dead ends have a possibility for you to not get another exit out of a room. Different types of traps, other players. Is there going to be PvP combat? Seems likely at the moment, but not necessarily. Enemies or monsters? What types of enemies or monsters? Stats. Where do we roll dice? Generating combat skills. All that kind of stuff. Materials. Materials are always important. So my last thought, I think, before I call this done for today, is that with the elements of searching the room and stuff like that, do the players have equipment? Can they change equipment? Are there obstacles that can be avoided with certain equipment? I'm reminded of the Games Workshop game Chainsaw Warrior, where, you know, you need a grappling hook to bypass certain areas, otherwise bad things happen to you. Stuff like that. So you know, that's a potential option. Whereas certain characters who have certain gear types could potentially avoid certain types of traps, but not other types. Stuff like that. And I realize that I'm being very trap-focused right now. And that's okay. So, yeah. I think that's it for today. So, Accidental Book Club. The Accidental Book Club is my way of reading properly the grand library of books about writing, design, and art that I have and have never kind of read. Because I'm the type who buys books and then sits on them, and if I don't read them within like a week, they kind of just go on the shelf and stay there. This week we are continuing on with Sid Field's screenplay. I'll flip that back around to the default there. Sid Field's screenplay. I'm really enjoying this. It still seems a little old-fashioned to me, but a lot of the stuff he says about character and narrative construction is 100% accurate, and it's stuff that I use every day when I'm working on writing projects. Unfortunately, I'm just been slacking like mad, and I'm still working on this, so it's gonna be another week. And the reason for that is, as much as I just want to move on and just read it in the off time, I feel weird about reading it and then not having a book club section on something relevant in the ending, something that's mind-blowing or changing. And feel free to give me comments on that, if you would rather see me just move on, or if you would, if you want me to just continue, or if you would rather I moved on, and then if there's something relevant, just bring it back up. We can try all kinds of things, but I think for next week, I am going to keep reading. At least at the moment, I will. So there is that. Anything else? Sorry, just to see if there's anything relevant that I wanted to bring up. There's some really cool character exercises in here that I will be doing on my prep stream, which will be Wednesday at 12 p.m. I'm either going to be doing this stuff, or I'm going to be doing a role-playing exercise, which might be fun. So, role-playing exercise actually sounds better right now because I'm doing a role-playing design competition, so we'll probably be doing that. So that'll be, Wednesday from 12 p.m. Eastern to 1:30 p.m. Eastern. Gonna do that. I'm excited. I'm very excited. Other than that, if you guys have any questions for me in the chat, please feel free. I'm happy to answer any questions about me, about what I'm doing, what the show's about, my background, whatever. Ask questions. I like interacting with you guys. But that's it for show content for today. I will be doing design again next weekend, because it'll be the last day. So hopefully, if I can keep on task properly during the week, you'll be able to see a lot more finished sort of style design elements. And we can talk about less questions and more like concrete things and actual writing and stuff. Any questions? Let me know. And of course, I'm available on Twitter, my Twitter handle being at FreakLabMidSap, or send me an email through the website. My email's on there. There's a little icon for it on the bottom of the splash page and on the main page. Give you guys a few minutes for the delay to catch up. Dun, dun, dun. Yep. All right. It doesn't look like there's anything at the moment. Like I said, send me a whisper, send me a tweet, send me an email. Happy to answer your questions. Other than that, I think I'm out for the night. I'm sweating like the dickens right now. It's so hot in here. Oh my god. It's been really hot recently, so just sweating, man. Just sweating. Anyway, thanks for coming to hang out with me. I hope y'all learned something. I certainly did. So yeah. Take it easy, guys. And gals.